Hi, my name is Alan Brown. I'm the Director of Development for the MKS Toolkit suite of products at PTC. This is the second in a pair of presentations describing activation. This one is a product demonstration. I do recommend that you previously view the technical briefing. So, I have here a Windows 8 virtual machine. It has been equipped with a start menu, which is very much like the Windows 7 start menu, really so that I can find things quickly for the purposes of demonstration. So you can see in front of you a CD image has been mounted, and we're ready to go ahead and do an installation. Prior to this, I have gone and created an activation account for myself. This involved going to a website, filling in my name and email address, and then clicking a link in an email that was delivered to me. Once that's done, I'm ready to go, and so let's just get started right away. I did create two different licenses for us. One which is a named authenticated user, the other which is concurrent. And the goal here is to run through an installation with either named or concurrent, and then at the end we'll go and do a few changes to that activation by switching the product key and maybe switching the number of users so that we can see how to do those basic tasks. So here we go. Remember what I said before in the presentation, in the technical briefing presentation, that there's a software license agreement that you have to accept. This agreement must be accepted by the owner of the machine, the person who's legally going to be bound, or someone who is authorized by that person to bind the owner of the machine to this contract. So here, the major difference between 9.2 and 9.4, 9.5, 9.6 is that the only real piece of information you have to enter here is the product key. So I have two different product keys. I have named and I have concurrent. So I'm going to grab the license off of the concurrent. You will also receive a PDF file, and it's very easy to just copy and paste the result from a PDF file. There we go. So now we know we have two concurrent authenticated users in this install. Now we've just got regular Toolkit for Developer things. What compiler do you want to use? I'm going to go ahead and use one of the Intel compilers and a few other simple things. Now this is where we get back into activation of interest. There is a privacy policy that you can see. You can see the data that we're going to send. So there is the information about the node, about the license, about the node. No, I'm wrong. This is not the... Here we have the information that gets sent from the activation software to the activation server. You can see here, this is the license information, which is Toolkit 9.6. Then we have host ID information, and we will put in username and password, and we'll put in a concurrent user account number that we pick. And you can gather information about the activation process from the MKS software website. So here, I have three alternatives open to me. I can activate later using the control panel applet, which is actually what I'm going to do in this case. I have not been supplied with a license.dat, but I might have been if I had a secure site license. Or I can activate right now. And if I activate right now, I can change this from 1 to 2. If I try and put in 3, 4, or 5, it's just going to come back with 2 anyway, because that's the maximum number that I have available to me. But for now, I'm just going to go ahead and wait and do this activation post-install, which, you know, for a virtual machine makes more sense anyway, because I would prefer that that I use UUID based activation, and I prefer to clone my virtual machines after the install and before the activation. Can do custom or typical, and I'm just going to go ahead and pick the pretty much a typical install. One thing that's different with 9.6, I will point out, is that the R tools are now an optional install, so you have to go through custom to get them. We felt that their time had passed, and the secure shell is the way to go. We had enough customers asking us to please not install them by default anymore, that we felt it was time to move them into optional installation. So we consider them insecure, we consider them historical artifacts. We still support them, of course, but now you have to go into the custom install to get them. So I'm going to change where I install to because I'm an old-fashioned nutcracker guy and I don't like spaces in my file names. And I'm going to go ahead and finish the install. So we'll pause here for a second while the files are copied, so you don't have to sit here and watch it. When we come back, we will see everything ready, and we can bring up the control panel. So here we've completed the copying of files, and we're being told that because we did not activate during installation, that we must activate at the end of installation. So at this point, we should be able to do things like running ls, and we would see that we are not activated. Machine is not activated. All right. So let's go ahead and have the installer launch the activation for us. We see we are not activated. We can just simply say we would like to activate, perhaps with one concurrent user. And at this point, we have the same information here, policy, data sent, and information about activation. We have two real choices here. One, which is to do an offline activation. And if we do that, we are given a packet that we can send to an offline activator. And we're told where to send it to. So we need to go here. So we can bring up a browser to here. And then we can copy and paste the activation request. Let's go back here. Let's copy the packet. Let's go to and activate it. Go. Oops, I must have entered the wrong username and password. So let's go back out of here. Yep, I've got a K missing. And can create a new offline packet. Simple as that. Back. Paste in the right one. See whether I got the password right this time. Apparently not, or I didn't paste it. Let's do this one online. Oh, I see, there's an extra dot in here. There we go. So, very simple. As I said, the majority of the issues are with username and password. That's almost always the case. If I now wish to change this, and by the way, we can go back here, we can run ls, we should be fine. If we run MKS info, that will tell us how many licenses we have. And if we run process minus AV, we will see in there what the active concurrent users are. So right there is the active concurrent users with the timeout left until that license is released. So I can change it to 2 very easily and see if I can get this right this time. I've now changed it from 1 to 2 concurrent authenticated users, and now I should be able to log in as someone else and run a second one in parallel. So that's very simple. Now, the next thing that we might want to do is to activate using a different key. So if we had an evaluation and we wanted to go to live software, we might want to change the product key. So we do have a second key here that we can use. So we'll go back into the license sent to us from PTC License Management, copy and paste it in. If it were just a little bit easier to copy and paste. All right, I give up. And there we go. So now we have named users. So at this point, I can add in particular user accounts, and then I can do a change. So for example, now the problem is with this one is that I only have local accounts accessible to me because this particular virtual machine is disconnected from its domain at the moment. But I should be able to put in an account name, check that name, and I should be able to say the same user account as I had before. And I should be able to change the activation. At this point, it will deactivate the two users that were named, will deactivate the two users who were concurrent and replace them with a single named administrator. At this point, I would not, one presumes, be able to run this anymore because that is in fact not me. And indeed, I am not on the named user list. So, and you can see here too that it is activated, but I'm not on the list. And I would point out that there is one other. I have also got the PCCX server installed on here and activated, and you can see that it is this information that it expects to be activated through the MKS Toolkit. Now, there are two ways in which the X server gets activated. So, if you have the enterprise developer version of MKS Toolkit or the interoperability version, in that case, the activation is done through the toolkit activation. If you don't, and in this case, I did use a Toolkit for Developers license. But I brought this dialog up while it was still licensed as part of Toolkit for Interoperability. And I had uninstalled and reinstalled the toolkit. But the idea is that there's a very similar dialog in the PTC X server for activation. It works fundamentally the same way as the toolkit one, and it has virtually the same look. You can see activate, change users, import, and change key. The import is used to bring in a license.dat if you happen to have one, and that's true for both X server and the MKS toolkit. So there we have the end of the demonstration, and I want to thank you for watching. If you have any questions, please do contact our technical support group, and they'd be happy to help you in any way, or they can get you in touch with me if you have any further questions that I can help you with. Thank you again.